The first station, Jesus is condemned to death. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Caiaphas, with a group of priests, has brought Jesus to the court of the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate. But Caiaphas does not enter the building.
We cannot go into Pilate's headquarters, or we will become ritually unclean and unable to eat the Passover. Go and ask the governor to come out to us.
Why have you brought this man to me? What has he done?
This is Jesus from Nazareth. He claims to be a king. We have seen him gathering followers and conspiring against the Roman kingdom. We have also seen him telling people not to pay taxes to the governor.
Jesus of Nazareth, I have heard of this man. Take him to yourself and judge him according to your Mosaic law.
We have already done our part, but we are not permitted to put anyone to death.
For bringing up here then, I have questions for him.
Sir, I have a message for the governor. Come and help me.
Urgent message for you, sir. Call me up, Parish.
My wife? She knows not to interrupt me in court. What does she say?
Jesus is an innocent man. Just yesterday, I have a bad dream about you. You have the power to release him. So do it immediately. And see to it that he is not caused any trouble.
Are you the king of Jews? What's the matter with you, Jesus from Nazareth? Why don't you answer me? Are you a king?
Are you asking me? Because these people have told.
Am I a Jew? It is your own people who have handed you over to me. What have you done?
You say I am a king, but I am not of this world. If it would, my followers would be fighting to prevent me from falling into the hands of the Jewish leaders. But I am not from here.
So you are a king then?
It is you who keeps calling me the king. I was born into this world to bear witness to the truth. And those who listen to the truth shall listen to my voice.
Truth? What truth? Whatever this man is, I see no charge against him. I would like to release him. I find no case against this man. But you have a custom that one prisoner is released on the Passover. So shall I release you, the King of Jews? Or Barabbas?
Jesus!
What shall I do with Jesus, who's called the Messiah?
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Why? I find no case against this man to sentence him for death. I shall have him flogged and release him.
If you let him go, you are no friend of Caesar.
Anyone who set themselves up as a king is an enemy of Caesar.
Enough!
Servant,
call up for the governor. I have no choice. I cannot save this man from this beast.
dictatorial power. They can't force you.
This is what they're trying. I can't risk the emperor's nose that I'd let a would-be king go free. What happens? Then I will be recalled to Rome. And then... your wish be granted, but I am innocent of this blood of this just man. See to yourself.
His blood be upon us and upon our children.
Take him away and flog him.
The Lord, who has every right to judge the human race, is being judged by the Pilate. Even though Pilate knew that Jesus was innocent, just and blameless, he condemned him to death. He was frightened of the Jewish religious leaders. He was terrified to lose his job as the governor of Palestine. He lost the opportunity to fight for justice. The attitude of Pilate tells us that no one can support both Jesus and injustice. You can't serve both God and the immortal standard of the world. You have to choose one. In the world today, it is the influence of money that writes judgment in the so-called courts of India. We, in our lives, defame and judge people living with us for our vested interest. We want to please people who can satisfy our own ego and internal motives. Even after knowing that a particular person is just and innocent, we spread evil about him. Friends, whenever we judge others, Jesus too is being judged. Lord Jesus, give us the grace not to judge anyone in this world.
Jesus accepts his cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Scourging was not a cakewalk, rather a brutal punishment. It was a standard practice before crucifixion. The whip has several thongs, and each had either a bone or a metal attached to it. The convicted person was tied to a pillar and beaten up so cruelly until his flesh hung in shreds.
Can you guess?
It is said that some even died during the scourging, and they would not reach the point of crucifixion. The worst thing was that the soldiers would not stop until they see what is inside the flesh.
You said that you are king of Jews, but you don't have a crown. Let me bring you a crown.
Remember, my dear friends, he is doing this for you and for me.
Get moving!
Hail, King of Jews!
The cross that Jesus carried was normally offered to a hardcore criminal. It was a symbol of shame. Besides, the way to Calvary was quite long. What offense did Jesus commit that he deserved crucifixion? He cured the lepers. He cast out the demons. He fed the hungry. He raised the dead. He did so many more good things. None of his actions proved that he deserved crucifixion. Then why did he carry the cross? He carried it for you and for me. He carried it in order to destroy Satan and his powers. For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake, he will save it. Jesus asks us to carry our own cross happily and walk with him. Let us follow him sincerely, with great determination and unfailing heart. Lord Jesus, give the grace to happily carry our cross and walk with you.
Third station, Jesus falls the first time. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Jesus is already beaten up so much. He has lost enough fluid and blood. He has not eaten anything for a long time. All of us know that according to the Roman custom, Jesus did not carry the whole cross, rather only the horizontal beam. The vertical beam was already erected and waiting for execution. Scholars say that it weighed around 45 kgs to 50 kgs. If you happen to say Jesus carried only 45 kgs, remember, Jesus is already, he is half dead. Even if a small child pushes him, he will fall down.
Lord, when I look back, I see the many painful moments in my past when I gave up on the mission of life. It seemed that failure was the final word in all my precious endeavors. I had given my best. Then there was nothing left. The thought of despair and self-pity overwhelmed me. I languished in the prison of hatred and despair. I then imagined the only way was to walk away from my commitments, relationships,
and the challenges of my responsibilities. I offer to you, Lord, every moment of my defeat. Looking at you staggering to rise up again with the cross on your shoulder, I take courage to follow your footsteps, to pick up the cross of my life and know that you are there ahead of me to show me the way. Lord Jesus, give me the grace to get up and walk after every fall or defeat.
Fourth station, Jesus meets his sorrowful mother. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Joseph was a carpenter. It was Joseph who taught him carpentry. As a carpenter, I have seen him carry so many woods. Those woods gave us food to eat. It gave us joy. The wood which he's carrying now pains me a lot. My innocent son is condemned to death. He is carrying the cross for you and me so that we can enjoy eternal bliss. As a child, he could not bear the pain when he stumbled into thorns. Just imagine, today the crown is made of thorns. His flesh is torn in shreds. But he is bearing it up for our salvation. As a child, I and his father lifted him up whenever he fell down. Today, I am helpless. I am his mother. His disfigured body tells my heart apart, but the shoe is broken. Oh God, your will be done.
Mary, who carried Jesus for 9 months in her womb, now sees him carrying the symbol of shame. It is a horrible scene for a mother to watch her own son suffer. Mary meets Jesus on the way to Calvary. The eyes meet and begin to speak. Showers of tears begin to roll down the cheeks. Of course, Mary is sad and devastated. We see Mary's pain in the mothers and fathers who watch their children giving up their life to drugs, addiction, and suicide. In the women and men who suffer violence and the ongoing threat of violence in their home from spouse or child. We see Mary's pain in the child coping with the breakdown of a parent's marriage, in the couple trying desperately to rebuild their relationship and family anew. Yet the look of Mary revives Jesus. Son, go on your journey. If the cross is the only way to salvation, fulfill it confidently. Today, if a son goes about doing good for society, the mother pulls him aside and says, "You mind your own business. Why do you carry others' burden on your shoulders?" But Mary sends her only son for the sake of the world. Remember what she said at the wedding at Cana. Do whatever he tells you. Lord Jesus, give us the grace to be like Mary, who always thought of others first.
Fifth station, Simon helps Jesus carry the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
It is only Mark who, in his gospel, writes down the names of the sons of Simon of Cyrene. They are Alexander and Rufus. What could be the reason?
Hey you, what's your name?
Simon, I'm not from around here. I come from Cyrene.
I don't care. Get hold of this cross and carry it. I don't want this fellow to be dying on the way.
Friends, this particular edition from Mark goes on to prove the authenticity of the event. In other words, the event took place for real. And the sons of Simon are the witnesses. Cyrene is today's Libya, which is a country in itself in North Africa. So, we are not contemplating on a fiction, but on history. Do you think that the soldiers will stop? You just wait and see.
Pain that is shared becomes half. Simon of Cyrene never expected that he would help Jesus. Something that he never expected happened in his life. he helped Jesus carry his cross for a short distance. No doubt the distance was short, yet he reduced Jesus' burden to a great extent. A great friend is the one who gives his shoulders when his or her friend is in need. The world today lost the real meaning of friendship. People stick to you when you have money and run away from you when you own nothing. But Jesus tells us, greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Lord Jesus, give us the grace to share the pain of our brothers and sisters whenever possible.
The sixth station, Veronica presents her veil to Jesus. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Jesus drags himself along, gasping. Yet the radiance of his countenance is undiminished. No amount of abuse can dim his beauty. The spittle and the blows were unable to obscure it.
Jesus, Jesus.
His face appears as a burning bush.
What are you trying to do?
Please allow me to give him this cup of water and wipe his face.
No, don't come on away.
Please, sir, allow me to do this favor. He has done so much for us.
Silent tears fall from the master's eyes.
Can't you understand? Are you a God man? Get out from here!
Hey, leave her! Let her do what she wants to do. After all, this man is tired.
He bears the burden of one forsaken. And yet Jesus advances. He does not stop. He does not turn back. Veronica wipes the face of Jesus, and the imprint of Jesus' face is on the cloth.
Lord, it is an indifferent world that we are living in. Everyone is busy trying to climb higher, even when it means trampling on others' lives. No one has the time to bind up the wounds of others or even to consider or care for the suffering humanity all around us. Everyone is in tears, every stomach crying for food, every distressed soul waiting for a touch of comfort in you, and my suffering Savior waiting to be consoled. When we dare to forget our own preoccupations and take time out to care for others, the magnificent love of your face will be imprinted on our hearts. Whenever we did it to the least of our brethren, it is you who is clothed, fed, and comforted. We offer to you, Lord, all the indifferences and arrogance in our hearts that turned us away from those in need. It was from you that we turned our face away. We pray, O Lord, may we never miss the grace
of the moment. Offered in the suffering brother and sister who come our way. May every person encountering me be drawn to long for your compassionate face.
Seventh station, Jesus falls the second time. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Truly, we see fulfilled in Jesus the ancient prophecies of the lowly and obedient servant who takes upon himself all our history of sorrows. So Jesus, prodded by the soldiers, stumbles, overcome by fatigue, surrounded by violence, utterly exhausted, increasingly alone amid the encircling gloom. His flesh is torn, his bone is weary. In him, we glimpse the bitter experience of those locked in prisons of every sort, with all their inhuman contradictions. Confined and surrounded, push hard and falling. He is so weak that he falls for the second time with the burdens of our sins.
Lord Jesus, when I look back to my past, I see many times my will failed me, and I fell in sin repeatedly. Failures crushed me. I was jeered at even by my near and dear ones for all the wrong decisions I had made. It was the good of those around that had prompted me then. Yet, even those whom I lived for did not care to utter a word of understanding. I was crushed by shame, self-pity and despair. The loneliness of my human existence hit me hard. As your face is pushed to the dust, the stones of the hard earth jab into your wounds. As you crawl on the ground under the weight of the cross, I come to you. Oh my God, praying for the strength of those moments when the struggle was beyond my strength. Give me a glimpse of the sure glory of heaven when the stand of the earth darkens my vision.
Eighth station, Jesus speaks to the weeping women. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
I have been to so many funerals, Did I cry? Not for everyone. For some people, I just could not stop my tears because they were close to me or they made a difference in my life. Now, look at the women of Jerusalem. You saw right off your eyes how the women of Jerusalem wept for Jesus. We do not know how they experienced Jesus, but we do know that their experience was intense. Otherwise, why would they cry for a man who lived far away from Jerusalem for most of his years? This attitude of women indicates to us that this man was different. He's different.
Look at Jesus and listen to his message for us today. Weep for the children who are abused. Weep for the women who are victimized. Weep for the men and women who suffer from tyranny of today's body image that controls their lives and prevents them from feeling lovable. Weep for the young who cannot find a job or a way in life. Weep for the old who are forgotten. Weep for the people who starve in shadow of abundance. Weep for the people who are homeless, in exile, or seeking refuge. Weep for the people who desire to be loved, understood, and cared for. Lord, open our hearts to the suffering of all the people in our world. Give us the generosity of spirit to help us recognize their pain.
Just the way you should.